Today, we will discuss on a very important topic, yield and cost estimation of VLSI chips. As an engineer, always you have to think the product which you are developing that must get a good market. In order to have good market, you have to always consider the cost estimation of that particular product. If you cannot offer your product at a reasonable price, means with respect to market competition, if the price is not low, at the same time, if the performance is not up to the mark, then that particular product will not get a good market. And obviously, within a short period, you will lose the market, and that is a blunder, that is a major major problem of your company. So that's why when you are designing some chips, here product is chips, VLSI chips, then you have to estimate the cost of that particular chip so that you can get a very good market, competitive market, and your product will survive in future. So for that, cost estimation of a particular product, here VLSI chip, is very important consideration. And here we will discuss now how the cost is estimated. And the cost of a particular product depends on the yield. That means the number of products you are coming out from the fab. Out of that, how many are of good condition, how many of you will give you better performance, good performance, then you will select those, and the bad ones has to be eliminated. So that way, if your yield is very high, obviously your profit will be more and you can sell the product at a lower price. But at the same time, if yield is poor, then obviously the cost of the product will be high. So those things will be discussed now, how the yield is defined and on what factors the cost of a chip is estimated, and on what are the problems or what are the reasons for poor yield of a VLSI chip. Those things we'll discuss now. Now, here the yield and cost estimation of the VLSI chips, for first things, what are the major components of the cost estimation of a VLSI chip? And the first component for cost estimation is initial investment cost. That means when you offer a product, then for that particular, for developing or realizing that particular product or chip, you have to have a lot of investment, which are initial investment, and those initial investment costs belong to the design cost, that is architecture design, logic design, electronic circuit design, layout design. Sequentially, all the four steps you have to follow for design a particular chip. Architecture, logic, electronic circuit, layout design details will be taught in future classes. Now, the second of this investment cost is prototype chip before production phase. That means you have to produce several versions of the chip before the actual production. And those are known as prototype version. And in those prototype version, you have to ensure the properties. You have to ensure the performance, good performance of the chip. If the performance is not up to the mark, then you have to redesign again. You may have to follow again the four steps of design, namely architecture design, logic design, electronic circuit and layout design. So then again you have to process fully for getting another prototype chip, and you have to test those chips until and unless you satisfy the performance of the chips. and then you can go for actual production. Now the prototype chip production phase has got lot of cost, and those costs involve the salaries of the personnel and designers, draft versions, computer time which are used basically for design purpose, material cost for prototype, mask, wafers and chips. These are the various components of prototype chip fabrication. And if the prototype fabrication continues 2-3 steps, means 2-3 batches, then this initial investment cost will be higher. Now, the next cost is manufacturing cost per package, which we denote as B. And if I denote initial investment cost by A, then and manufacturing cost per package is B, then we will get the final cost which relates both A and B. Now, what is meant by manufacturing cost per package? So here, the packages in the cost involve fabrication of each chip, assembly in a package. You have to, after fabrication, the good chips are to be sorted out, and those chips are assembled. That means you have to go for chip bonding, wire bonding, then encapsulation or molding in a package. So there's all these costs known as assembling in a package. Then testing and package. So cost per IC package, which I denote by C, will be given by A by V plus B, where A is the initial investment cost and B is the manufacturing cost per package, and V is the production volume. Production volume means in a particular batch, how many number of chips you are getting. So that is the production volume. So A by V, that means those production volume, those number of chips, the initial investment cost will be divided by that. Then you will get per chip what is the initial investment cost, plus B here manufacturing cost, that is per package. So this together will give you the total cost of a particular chip. Now, C equal to A by V plus B. Now, on what factors the cost can change, and how the cost varies by change of A and B. Fabrication cost for each wafer is fixed, so yield, which is Y, must be high to reduce B. Since B is the fabrication cost per chip, it fully depends on the yield. Yield means how many good chips you are getting in a particular process. So that is the fabrication cost per chip. So yield is high means this cost B, second term, will reduce a lot. Then total cost also will reduce. If A is large, normally A is large for LSI, VLSI, that is the initial investment cost is large for large scale integration circuits or VLSI circuits, but it is small in small scale integrated circuits, SSI. A means initial investment cost is low in case of SSI. If V is large, that means production volume is large, first term in C is small. This particular term is very small compared to the second term. And then you can assume C is almost equal to B. C is almost equal to B, approximately equal to B, only when the production volume is very large. Now, what will be the selling price of an IC package? The selling price of an IC package will be equal to C, which is the cost per package, plus indirect cost, plus profit. Now comes, what do you mean by the indirect cost? Indirect cost involves sales support, administrative support, personnel, electrical support, etc. Sales support means every company is having some sales department. There, lot of people works to market that particular product. So their salaries and their travel expense, etc., are involved, so that their office expenditure is also involved. That all together known as sales support. Then comes administrative support, personnel salaries. Lot of personnel will be involved for production of a particular VLSI chip. This consists the design, fabrication, engineers and scientists, their salaries and their overhead expenditures will be there. That means the laboratory overhead expenditure and the initial investment cost of the equipments, etc., that is also involved. So these are there. Then electrical support. So electrical cost is another parameter for a particular product. So then all these components together will give you the indirect cost plus profit. You have to make some profit, otherwise no companies can survive. So that means C, that is cost per package plus indirect cost plus the profit. Three together gives you the total sale price of a particular IC package. Now, typical cost analysis, including test costs, if we can compare, then we'll see in this table that how much percentage is the chip fabrication cost, how much is the packaging cost, how much is the testing cost. In this table, we have compared three chips, SSI, MSI, and LSI chips. In SSI, small scale integrated circuit, we are comparing it 50 mil square is the chip area and 14 pin IC. In case of MSI, this is 80 mil square is the chip area, 1 mil is 1000th of an inch, and 16 pin IC. And in LSI, it is 130 mil square and it is 24 pin IC. Just to have an idea how the total cost, in the total cost, how much component is fabrication, how much component is package, and how much is the test cost. So we have taken help of three chips, which 14 pin, 16 pin, and 24 pin ICs. So there you can see from this table that chip fabrication cost in case of SSI is 20% only, packaging cost is 75%, and test cost is 5%. But in MSI, we have 16 pin IC, 80 mil square chip area, chip fabrication cost is around 45%, packaging cost is again 45%, and test cost is again 10%. But in case of LSI, where 24 pins are used, so their chip fabrication cost is 70%, and packaging cost is 20%, and test cost is 10%. Now we see here, if we go from SSI level to MSI to LSI, again to VLSI, if we go, then the chip fabrication cost increases rapidly, and packaging cost reduces there because chip size is large, and test cost is after in MSI, LSI, and VLSI level almost 10%. So that is a typical values for analysis of cost, including this testing of the chips. Now we'll switch over to the design approaches of VLSI chip, because in cost estimation there is a component of design cost. So in the design approaches, we'll see here there are several methods of design approach. One method is known as full custom design approach. So that is, production volume is high, chip is designed painstakingly, taking a long period of time. Second one is semi-custom design approach. In semi-custom design approach, production volume is low. First term in C is higher than B, that is the cost. What is the first term? A by V, and the second term is B. A by V is the production volume, A is the initial investment cost, so A by V. And there in semi-custom design approach, the first term, that is A by V, is higher than B. There we use logic methodology and CAD. CAD is computer aided design techniques. Now, third approach is a cell library approach. In this particular design approach, A is less, but B is not less because Y is poor. The C equal to A by V plus B, the second term B, manufacturing cost per package, is not less in case of cell library approach. Why it is not less? Because in cell library approach, the yield is poor. If the yield is pure, automatically the manufacturing cost per package, that is B, will be high, and the total cost will be A component will be less, but B will be high. So these are the three different approaches. In these three approaches, full custom design approach, there particularly ASICs are designed there, and in cell library approach is easiest. There some cell library means some design cells are used for designing a particular chip. Some of the cells are pre-designed and those are kept, because you don't have to spend a lot of time designing the cells. You can just like gate arrays, etc., you can design of gate arrays, you can choose cells and you can put those blocks to design a particular VLSI chip, and there the initial investment cost obviously will be very low, because there the initial cell design cost is not included, that is already available, and you can take those cells and you can interconnect those cells to have your circuit. But the problem is you cannot change the inside schematic of the cell, and for that reason you may have to forego some of the stringent requirements of your chip, your goal which you want to achieve. You may have to forego some percentage of that, and for that you may not get very high yield of your chip which you want to design. So that is the case with the cell library approach. But in case of full custom, you have to design from the scratch. That means no cells are used from the transistor level, resistance level, that means semiconductor component level, you can start designing. So automatically there the design cost, that means first component, the initial investment cost will be high, because you may have to go several iterations, the batch has to be processed to achieve the final objective of those chips. So that's why in full custom design approach, cost will be higher than the cell library approach. Now, we consider the yield of ICs. I mentioned that yield of VLSI chips must be very high in order to reduce the cost. And there comes several considerations, means how to improve the yield of a particular VLSI chip. The yield basically related with the manufacturing side, manufacturing area. Because of the problem of manufacturing process, the yield may be poor, and also it responsibility lies with the packaging and assembly section also. But the design side, almost it is perfect. The yield is poor, not because of the design, because design has already verified, and in prototype we are satisfied with the design, then we go for actual manufacturing. The poor yield, the reasons may be due to the different faults or defects in fabrication, assembling and packaging. And we'll discuss, we now find out what are those points which normally brings down the yield of a particular VLSI chip. Before that, we have to define the yield, how the yield is defined. Now, yield of IC is defined by number of faultless chip divided by number of all products into 100. So that is expressed in percentage. number of faultless chip divided by number of all products into 100. That particular value will give you the yield. It is expressed in percentage. And it is proportional to K1 into e to the power minus K2 into A, where A is the chip area. K1 and K2 are constants. This K1 here and this K2, they are constants and they are dependent on gross fail area and defect density. K2 is dependent on defect density and K1 is dependent on gross fail area. So with this is a sum of the modeling of the yield. A is the chip area, obviously. If the area of the chip is large, so automatically e to the power minus k2d will be low, so yield will be poor. That means if we go for larger size ICs, that means if the chip area is large, then automatically yield will be poor. Because in a large area, silicon area, there may some defects in the semiconductor crystal itself, there may some defect during the processing. But if the chip area is small, then probability of the problems and defects over the small area may not be so high. So that's why if A is small, that means which is in case of SSI, the yield will be high if A is small. If A is large, then large area chips, e to the power minus k2d, this term is low, so yield will be poor. So in VLSI chips of larger area, the yield will be poor because of larger area. And at the same time, because of the factor K2. K2 is the defects density, and those defects come for various reasons. Now, in case of bipolar VLSI chips, the Y is small, but Y in MOS ICs is large. So in case of most VLSI chips, normally yield is very high because of the simplicity and less complexity in the fabrication of MOS ICs. And why the yield in SSI is nearly 90% and that of LSI is 10 to 15% and VLSI is sometimes less than 10%. But now this picture has changed, this yield percentage has changed now because of some innovations of technology, some new technology concept, and there are some in situ diagnostic tools available nowadays. So because of that reason, we can correct the process you can correct the different parameters of the process during total sequence, during the sequence. So VLSI yield now has achieved more than 10-20% also. That is of the because nowadays the more or less various automations are coming into the VLSI fabrication. Human interaction is becoming less and less in fabrication sequence. So that is the reason of achieving higher yields in VLSI nowadays. But in earlier times, the VLSI chip yield was 10% or 15% like that. Now, yield of ICs, what are the determining factors? What are the different parameters which are bringing down the yield of ICs? We will discuss now those points one by one. The first point is the improvement of the process yield has serious implications for both processing and design. Normally, VLSI yield is limited by killing defects. So the defects, we'll call it as a killing defects, because the defects will kill the device. That's why they are termed as killing defects, which are classified as large area and point defects. Large area defects are scratches, because scratches are made over large area due to poor wafer handling, incomplete etches, non-uniform deposition rates. They are the different parameters, because different things due to which you can get large area defects. And point effects are associated with deposited layer and are major yield limitations. Because in your fabrication process, you will use different layers which are deposited either by sparkling technique or by CVD technique or by vacuum evaporation. Those deposited layers will introduce some point defects, and these they are major yield limitation. Substrate defects like stacking faults, slip, dislocations are often related to poor thermal process, incomplete annealing, and low quality epi layer. Epitaxial layer and the annealing process will be studied in detail. There you will find when you grow the epi layer is single crystal layer grown on a substrate material which is also silicon. And in the growth of the single crystal thin layer of silicon, some defects appear. Those defects are stacking faults, slip, and dislocations. Individual defects characterization and their definitions will be discussed in during the discussion of epitaxial growth process. And sometimes poor thermal process may also produce some defect because of the mismatch of thermal expansion coefficient, and they because of the mismatch of TCE, micro cracks may appear. Deformation of the different layers, thin layers may take place. So for that reason, the yield may be poor. Now, besides this, the killing defects, besides the bulk epitaxial faults, there are some other problems which also determine the which are also working as a determining factors for poor yield of VLSI chips, and they are now mentioned here. Dust particles in photoresist process, because dust particle may act as a as an opaque point, an opaque body, opaque area in case of photoresist exposure during photoresist exposure. So they may act as a mask material, and accordingly you may have undesired pinholes on the films, means oxide films, which will through which the dopant impurities can go inside the semiconductor layer. So these dust particles has a detrimental effect on the photolithography process and subsequent diffusion and ion implantation process. Now, insufficient etching. If the etching is not complete, that means when you are opening windows in oxide layer for further diffusion of impurities, so if etching is not sufficient, then they may protect some layer, and through those layer, the dopant atoms cannot freely diffuse into silicon, and desired profile you may not get. The next point is misalignment of mask. When you are going for photomasking process, there is a chance of misalignment, and the misalignment may be due to the operators, may be due to the machine tolerance, may be of various reasons, may be misalignment in the mask design itself, there may be some misalignment. So whatever the reason, misalignment of the different layers during photomasking process is one of the reason for poor yield of VLSI chips. Next coming, chemical contamination. The contamination are also not desired in any step of VLSI process. So we have to get rid of the contaminations in chemicals. So there we'll discuss thoroughly what are the contaminations normally found in chemicals and how we can get rid of those contamination in wafer cleaning and the clean room discussion. Image blurring. The image blurring is a basically geometrical effect when you are exposing using the exposure tool during photomasking process. the image blurring may take place. So there, because of the image blurring, you may not get clear open window. So accordingly, the diffuse layer will not be properly defined, and it may introduce defect also, which will reduce the yield. The broken metal connection caused by sharp discontinuity in metal thickness. So that is the metal broken connections, broken pieces may short circuit interconnect lines, and it may also open circuit when some of the interconnect lines are coming up. So that may produce either short circuit or open circuit in both is possible in metal lines. Damage by scribing and breaking process. After fabrication of the chip, you have to dice it. So before dicing, you have to scribe using the diamond cutter, and then you break the wafer into small pieces. During that scribing and dicing process, if the dicing and scribing is not proper, then maybe some of the devices which have been built in the bulk of semiconductor may be damaged, and which may kill the complete IC. So dicing and scribing process also to be perfect to have higher yield of VLSI chips. Next is imperfect bonding. When you are making bond of the bonding pads with the package post, so to say. So during that process, if bonding is not proper, that means if dry soldering takes place there, so that may affect the connection of the chip with the external wall. So because of that, the yield may be poor, and that is also detected in after packaging, because you normally test the chips before packaging and after packaging. Before packaging, you may get quite good yield. That doesn't make any sense. Ultimately, the chips are used after complete assembly and packaging. If during assembly and packaging there are errors, there are defects, so after packaging, then yield will be poor. So we have to take precaution during the assembly packaging, that means during the bonding process and the subsequent encapsulation or molding process. Next, leads may not sealed completely. After bonding is over, you cover the chip with some leads and you seal ultimately. If sealed is not proper, then moisture will leak into the package, causing chemical erosion. So this chemical erosion may damage the chip. It may affect the metallization lines, and they, because of that, there may be some open circuit in the metallization lines, and because of that, the total chip may not function properly. So these are the different determining factors of poor yield of VLSI chips. So during the fabrication of the chips, we have to take precaution so that neither of these problems appear, and each individual process step is highly perfect, then we can expect higher yield of VLSI chips. Now, I would like to point out that what are the different topics I will cover in this VLSI technology course. And this particular course is have divided into different part. The first part of this course contains discussion on unit processes, because in a VLSI process sequence, there are a lot of unit processes, mainly oxidation, diffusion, lithography, ion implantation, etc. And those unit process individual will be discussed in detail, and that will be done in the first part of this lecture course. And there, the topics are like this. First, I'll start discussion on contamination and cleaning. Then oxidation. Oxidation means how the silicon is converted into silicon dioxide, either by thermal process or by deposition process. We can get silicon dioxide also. By sparking process also we can get silicon dioxide. Various methods of formation of silicon dioxide layer will be discussed in oxidation, along with the kinetics of oxide growth, thermal oxide growth also will be discussed in this particular chapter. Next is lithography. Lithography is very important step. By this process, lithography process, which is also known as photomasking process, we can transfer any design on a mask onto the wafer, and by this process we can define metal pattern lines, as well as we can define the diffusion windows for further implantation and diffusion. So this unit process will be discussed in detail. Next is etching. Lithography is followed by etching to have the desired pattern, either in oxide layer or metal film. There are two types of etching process. One is known as wet chemical etching, other is known as dry etching process, which is plasma etching or microwave plasma etching or the ion milling or ion beam etching, etc. Those details of and physics behind the etching process will be discussed in detail in the etching process, in etching classes. Now diffusion. Diffusion is a process by which you can incorporate impurity atoms into the silicon. So the diffusion furnaces will be discussed in detail, diffusion sources, and how the diffusion is modeled. Modeling of diffusion process also will be discussed. Then comes ion implantation. Ion implantation is a technique by which also you can incorporate the impurity dopants in a desired selected area to change the conductivity of a particular layer, semiconductor layer, or to change the type of the layer. That means from n-type to p-type, p-type to n-type, you can do that by incorporation of particular doping atoms, and that can be done by ion implantation techniques. And ion implantation is a very controlled way you can make the, you can incorporate the diffusion dopant atoms, and you can have the doping profile at your desire. And various kinds of doping profiles can be obtained using ion implantation techniques. So that will also be discussed in detail. Next is epitaxy. Epitaxy is a process by which you can grow single crystal thin layer over a substrate, and this layer on the substrate will have same crystallographic configuration, and that layer, the epitaxial layer, high purity epitaxial layer will be used to make the VLSI, different components of the VLSI chip. Then deposition of thin films of metals or dielectrics or semiconducting even films, polysilicon or even silicon, may be done by sputtering or by chemical vapor deposition or by ion beam deposition. So various techniques of thin film depositions will be discussed. Next unit process is metallization, and in this particular process we can make contacts, and we can form the interconnect lines on the VLSI chip. By making contacts and interconnect lines, we can configure a particular circuit, and those interconnect lines are connected with bond pads for testing purpose. So details of the metallization process and what are the problems and failure mechanisms in VLSI chips, those are the major contents in unit process metallization class. Now assembly and packaging. After fabrication of the chip, you have to assemble it. That means the chip is separated and it is bonded over a substrate, and then bonding pads are connected to the external leads by using certain thin wires, gold or aluminium wire of 25 micron thickness. And after that, we package, means encapsulate the complete chip to protect it from the environment. So that is the purpose of assembly and packaging, and that is the last unit process we will discuss in this particular course. All these unit process contained in the part 1 of this lecture schedule. Then comes part 2. Part 2 of the VLSI technology course deals with IC process. So different IC processes are there. For example, bipolar process, MOS, CMOS process. Then comes BIMOS or BICMOS process, and advanced processes for VLSI and ULSI. All those processes will be dealt in part 2 of this VLSI technology course, and details of the process steps along with cross-section schematic diagram will be given to you, and it will be thoroughly discussed, which contains the requirement of each step and how the different advancement of VLSI processes have been incorporated in the recent CMOS or BICMOS process. That also will be discussed in this IC process part 2 of this VLSI technology course. Now, VLSI technology deals with substrate, means its type, orientation, resistivity, active epitaxial layers, that means active layer contains epitaxial layer, CVD layer, CVD chemical vapor deposition layer, MB, which is molecular beam epitaxy, LP, liquid phase epitaxy, MOCVD, metal organic chemical vapor deposition. All these techniques are used to get active epitaxial layers, and details of all these processes will be dealt in unit process of deposition of thin films, that topic. Now comes buffer layer. Buffer layers are oxide, nitride and semiconductor. Silicon dioxide, silicon nitrides are the two major buffer layers which are used in various stages of bipolar and CMOS VLSI process. Semiconducting layers are also used, like polysilicon layers we are using in recent CMOS and NMOS VLSI process. Then comes diffusion, implantation. They are used for doping control amount of dopant atoms, for controlling the type and conductivity of a particular semiconductor layer. Polysilicon growth, which includes gate material, emitter interconnects, etc. Next is oxidation, nitridation. They are used for masking properties and for getting the dielectric films. And oxidation, nitridation, the growth of oxide and nitride film, along with how they are deposited, that also will be discussed, and they are important layers, masking layers, in case of implantation and diffusion process. Lithography is another important topic of VLSI technology, and there are several kinds of lithography. Optical lithography, where the optical radiation is used, X-ray lithography, where the source of radiation is X-rays, and electron beam lithography or ion beam lithography. Those are advanced lithography process by which we can make mask also. Next comes etching, chemical etching, dry plasma etching, ion beam etching. They are all used in modern VLSI process to get fine lines for either interconnection or for diffusion or ion implantation. They are obtained by the dry process or advanced ion beam process. Metallization, refractory metals and alloy materials are also used for metallization purpose. There we have to look into how the low resistivity, means high conductivity, narrow metal lines can be achieved. At the same time, we have to see the metallization problems and failure mechanism will be as less as possible. And those problems are the hillock formation, electro migration, junction spiking. These are the problems of metallization, and those problems are solved by proper choice of materials, by proper innovative techniques, by choosing certain alloy compositions, and those will be discussed in metallization class. Now, passivation. Passivation is the layer which protects the IC from environment, because after fabrication of the IC, the upper surface of the chip is covered by some protecting layer, and those protecting layers may be made of the silicon dioxide, silicon nitride, or some polymer materials, and they protect the IC from environmental hazards. So these are the various topics which has to be learned in detail to understand a particular VLSI process sequence or VLSI technology. Now, let me give you certain reference books which you can follow in progress of this course to have further idea and to have much more understanding of that particular, of this particular subject, of different, on different topics. You can go through in detail from these reference books, which are namely, first reference is SMJ, VLSI Technology, second edition, McGraw-Hill publication in 1988. Second book is C.Y. Chang and SMJ, that is ULSI Technology. This is the edited book, ULSI Technology, McGraw-Hill publication, and it published in 1996. The third book which I am referring is S.A. Campbell, The Science and Engineering of Microelectronic Fabrication, Oxford University Press, appeared in 1996. And another book I am referring is S.K. Gandhi, the author, and name of the book is VLSI Fabrication Principles, Silicon and Gallium Arsenide, published by Wiley, New York, 1983. You can follow any of these four books for further studies and to have in-depth knowledge on various aspects of VLSI fabrication. Let me stop here in this.
Let me now familiarize you with the deionized water plant. In every wafer cleaning stage, the silicon wafer is often rinsed with DI water. Normal water contains a lot of impurity ions which may cause inorganic contamination. DI water is highly pure water, free from inorganic ions. The resistivity of the DI water is in the range of 12 to 16 mega ohms because it is free of ions. Notice the four cartridges of the DI water plant. These cartridges are used to remove the inorganic impurities. The first cartridge is a pre-filter, the second an organic filter, the third an inorganic filter, and the fourth one is the final filter. We start the deionizing process using distilled water. Now you can see what happens to the silicon wafer after cleaning. A thin greenish layer of silicon dioxide is formed on the wafer surface. Notice that wafer droplets stick to the silicon dioxide coated surface. This is the hydrophilic characteristic of silicon dioxide. As soon as the oxide is totally removed to get bare silicon, water no longer sticks to the surface. Therefore, silicon is hydrophobic by nature. To remove the native oxide, we dip the wafer in a hydrofluoric acid bath. If you watch carefully, you will find that no water sticks to the silicon surface. The silicon wafer is now being spin dried. The wafer is placed in a spinner assembly. When the spinner rotates, because of the centrifugal force, liquid droplets are thrown off and the wafers are dried.